can be tough. Woo! It's a good one today, guys. Whew, I hope you're ready.
This is probably the most bizarre case that I have covered so far on my channel. And people love the idea that this individual may have had a double life, that she may have had all of these deep, dark secrets that she kept covered and hidden from her family. But I really wanna know your thoughts. So please let me know down below. You might wanna grab a snack. This is going to be a long video, I guarantee it. There is a lot to cover. So grab a snack, grab a pillow, relax. Let's get started. Welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, my name is McKenna and I tell the stories of those who can't tell it themselves. I want to thank you for joining me today, and if you haven't done so already and you want to learn more about missing persons and hopefully help bring somebody home to their family, please
hit that subscribe button and ring the notification bell.
As per usual, moving forward, you will no longer see
my face,
but you will see pictures of the people and places that we are talking about. So with that being said, let's go ahead and get started. This is the case of Sneha Philip. Sneha's family realized that she was missing on arguably one of the worst days in United States history. On September 11th, 2001, Sneha's family came to the terrible realization that she was nowhere to be found. She was last seen and known to be safe on September 10th. Let's go ahead and start with just a little background on who Sneha is. This beautiful woman and her husband, Ron Lieberman, were both physicians. They were both in the midst of their residency program at different hospitals in New York City. She married Ron in 2000, so they were definitely newly married. On the morning of September 10th, Ron accompanied Sneha to a court appearance, and then, according to Ron, they went out for breakfast together, and then he headed off to work. He said that she told him that her plans were to go back home and clean up around the house because they were preparing for a visit from one of Sneha's cousins within the next few days. Ron said that when he arrived home at around 10 to 11 p.m. that evening, their apartment was empty and Sneha was nowhere to be found. He was not concerned by this because she was known to go out and spend the night at either her friend's house or a cousin's house, and so he truly wasn't concerned. While she usually called him to relay her plans, he wasn't worried and he went to bed. When he went to work on the morning of September 11th, Sneha was still not home. Now, I'm briefly going to give you a simple timeline of the events that occurred on 9/11 because I think it's imperative to understand the mass chaos that engulfed New York City to truly understand the circumstances around her disappearance. At 8:46 a.m., the first plane hit the North Tower. Initially, people did not know that this was a terrorist attack. In fact, that did not even become conceivable until the South Tower was hit at 9:03 a.m. As you can imagine, everybody in the city was attempting to make calls and reach out to their loved ones, but given the fact that the bandwidth was so saturated and one of the largest and most widely utilized cell towers was on top of the World Trade Center, nobody could get through. Ron was just leaving a meeting when the first plane hit, and he attempted to call Sneha numerous times. She did not own a cell phone, so he had no option but to call their home phone. And when he was actually able to get through, no one would answer the phone. He actually caught a ride with an ambulance, and I'm assuming this was because he was a doctor, maybe he had some connections, and maybe the ambulance was heading that way anyways. But regardless, he hopped on, but just to get from the hospital to downtown, it took 6 hours. I will definitely be including images of the scene and the aftermath, but I just don't think that we can fully grasp the chaos experienced that day. Imagining what it must have felt like to be in the midst of that hell and not know if your spouse was okay. I think of the firefighters knowing as they entered those buildings that they would likely not be going home that night, or the people on those top floors of those buildings knowing they were never going to make it down. I just can't begin to digest that because it is almost paralyzing. So imagine you are Ron, trying to get home, unable to reach your wife. It takes you 6 hours to get there. And then, as he arrives, he can't even enter the building. The doors to the building were run by electricity, but all of the power was out in the building, so there was no way to get in. This was the case for a lot of the buildings in the city at this point, so he spends the night at a friend's house and is still unable to get in contact with Sneha. He was able to get into their apartment building the following morning, and when he arrived, he was completely confused. A window in the apartment had been left open, and the apartment was completely covered with ash, which in itself isn't entirely strange. You see this in a lot of images from that day, and it is very eerie. But what struck him most was the fact that the only footprints in the apartment belonged to their cat, and there was not any evidence that Sneha had been in the apartment during or after the attack. So obviously Ron reached out to Sneha's family, and it wasn't clear if he did this before or after returning to the apartment, but I don't think that that's relevant to her case necessarily. I just wanted to be as specific as possible with you. So her family hasn't seen or heard from her since September 10th. Her mom said that she and Sneha had an IM conversation, which, if you don't know what that means, it stands for instant messaging, much like texting or DMing, but through a browser like AOL. And she said that Sneha had seemed completely normal. Sneha stated that she had to run some errands, but what worried her family was that she had also mentioned that one of her friends was going to be getting married in Windows on the World. Now, Windows on the World was a restaurant venue in the World Trade Center, I believe perhaps on the 106th or 107th floor, definitely on a very high floor, and Sneha said that she might swing by to see her friend prior to the wedding. Now, we have no confirmation that she actually did go to the restaurant that day or any other day, but of course, this sent up giant red flags. Could she have been in the tower at the time it was attacked? Of course, they filled out a missing persons report, but so many people were reported missing that day. We're talking thousands and thousands of people. If you've never been to the 9/11 Memorial Museum, they have actual bulletin boards covered, and I mean covered, with missing persons flyers. It absolutely takes your breath away. So needless to say, when they told police that she was last seen on September 10th, her case got even less attention. Of course, they took the report, but all of the media coverage, all of their attention, was on victims of 9/11. So in order to combat this, Sneha's brother developed this story about how he was on the phone with Sneha when the tower was hit. He said she was in Windows on the World, but that she couldn't leave because people were hurt and she needed to help them. He said he was on the phone with her and then lost connection. Was her brother telling the truth about being on the phone with Sneha at the time of the attack? No, absolutely not. This story is entirely fabricated. Do I think it's right? No, but do I also understand the desperation in knowing that Sneha wouldn't receive any news coverage without this lie? Yes, I do. People do crazy things when they are desperate, so I can, at the very least, understand that and be sympathetic towards that. While his lie initially did achieve the intended goal of receiving news coverage and attention, it muddled her case because the story was completely made up. Should they even be looking in the rubble for her remains? We don't know. The investigation leads them in an intriguing direction. Video surveillance on the 10th shows Sneha returning to her apartment after her court appearance, just like Ron described. Her computer shows that she was logged in from about 1 to 4 p.m., which makes sense because this lines up when Sneha's mother said she was IMing her. She logs off her computer around 4 in the afternoon, and then she is next seen at 5:18 in the early evening, leaving her apartment building. We know that she first stopped at the dry cleaners to drop off some clothing items. She is then seen on surveillance footage at a Century 21, which, if you are not familiar, is a high-end clothing store in the city. I will link the Crime Junkie podcast below. They have the video footage of Sneha in the Century 21, and to be honest, it looks completely normal. Nothing stands out to me as concerning or bizarre. She's wearing the exact same clothing that her husband claims she was wearing that morning, and she appears to be casually shopping, as I would expect anyone to look if they were just perusing a clothing store. At about 6 o'clock p.m., she uses her husband's credit card to purchase bed linens, a dress, pantyhose, and lingerie. Odd purchases, but we will talk about that shortly. Now, she looks to be alone, but the cashier who took Sneha's payment said that she was with another Indian woman. We never see her on any surveillance footage, so was this woman attempting to remain unseen? Was she just never in the right place at the right time to be viewed on security tapes? Or was the cashier mistaken or confusing her with another customer, and there was never another woman with Sneha to begin with? We don't truly know the answer to that, and I don't think we ever really will. What we do know is that the cashier claims that she left with this woman and that this was the last confirmed sighting of Sneha. So I want to quickly talk about what Sneha bought at Century 21. So many theories have circulated about what she bought and why. We know that Sneha enjoyed the nightlife of New York. She would often go out drinking, and investigators learned that in the past, Sneha had been known to spend the night at the homes of people she truly didn't know. Of course, this knowledge contributed to theories that she had been having an affair, and I want to address that by saying that no one has ever come forward as having had an intimate relationship with Sneha, but you are forced to wonder if this is why she was buying lingerie. But the Crime Junkie podcast points out an intriguing idea, and that is that Sneha had discussed the fact that her friend was getting married at Windows on the World, so could she have been buying lingerie and bed linen as a wedding gift? I have not seen any sources that attest to the size of the bed linen. I don't know if bed linen even denotes a whole set of sheets, a comforter, pillowcases. So there is no way for us to even know if this bed linen was intended for the bed that she and Ron shared. I actually had the thought that even if you just buy a blanket at some stores or a throw pillow, depending on what store you are shopping at, other items could be categorized on a receipt as bed linen. So we actually can't be certain what she bought. But what we do know is that the items and the bags that those items were in were never found in her apartment or anywhere else. Now, of course, investigators review video footage from her apartment building security cameras to see if she ever returned to her home. They reviewed all of the footage from the 10th and into the 11th, and at approximately 8:40 in the morning on September 11th, a woman looking like Sneha enters the lobby of the apartment building. If you don't remember, or if you were not alive on 9/11, let me just tell you, it was the sunniest, clearest day that I can ever recall. There was genuinely not one cloud in the sky. So just by chance, the sun is coming into the lobby, and it is so bright that there is a definitive glare on the screen of the camera, so we cannot with full certainty confirm that this is Sneha. Her husband does attest to the fact that the woman's body shape, build, and clothing that she was wearing that day do appear to be Sneha, but you cannot confirm this through the video surveillance. We also see that this woman is not carrying any of the bags that Sneha would have had from Century 21. If this is Sneha, where did those bags go? On the video footage, we see her enter the lobby, stand in front of the elevator for a moment, and then turn and leave the building. She never appears on video surveillance again before the building loses power. Now, we know that the North Tower was struck at 8:46 in the morning, and if this is Sneha, could she have heard the chaos ensuing outside and, as a doctor, fled the building to help those that were injured? I do not believe that the video footage shows her standing at the elevator for 6 minutes. I could not find a source that referenced the length of time she was seen there, but like the Crime Junkie podcast states, it wouldn't be crazy to think that the camera could have been programmed a few minutes off and that it was actually closer to 8:46 when this woman entered the building than previously assumed. So, this is one theory, but I've also seen another theory, and that is, if this was Sneha, did she see what was happening, see the mass chaos, and decide that this was the perfect time to walk away from her life without a trace? Investigators found that Sneha's life was not quite what it appeared to be. At the end of her second year of residency, Sneha was terminated from her residency program. They claimed that she was terminated due to tardiness and alcohol-related issues. This is when information came to light that she was spending a lot of time going out drinking and crashing at other people's places. Sneha disagreed with her termination, obviously, and she actually claimed that she was terminated out of retaliation because she had rejected unwanted advances from a colleague. When she was let go, she actually filed a sexual harassment complaint, which stated that she believed she was not terminated for reasons cited by the program, but for reasons that we just discussed. Obviously, this claim is investigated, but what they find, and you can view this as either objective or subjective, depending on how you look at it, was that her claims were unfounded, and they actually threatened to take her to court and charge her with filing a false claim. And she said, F that. She said, I'm not backing down. I'm not recanting my report. I'll see you in court. I work at a teaching hospital with a residency program, so I had the unique opportunity to talk with a GME coordinator, which is basically the person who coordinates the medical education for residents. And she made it clear that being terminated from a residency program is no joke, because this can affect how and if you are able to be credentialed as a practicing physician. So this could mean years and years of education down the drain, and it could mean that what you've worked for nearly 10 years in the case of Sneha at this point could mean nothing. But the plot thickens. She was able to procure herself a spot in another residency program, which required her to regularly attend an alcohol counseling program. She missed at least one of the classes and was suspended from the new residency program that she was accepted to. The drama that surrounds theories about her personal life just continue to pile on. Throughout the investigation, it is rumored that Sneha was bisexual and that the nights she spent out partying were actually spent meeting and being intimate with women. These rumors stem from the fact that she spent most, if not all of her time, out partying at gay or lesbian bars. Now, I do not identify as lesbian or bisexual, but I love myself a gay bar, so I can't honestly say that this fact for me has any credibility. However, there are two police reports that give some weight to this theory. The police report states that after Sneha's court appearance, she and Ron got into a verbal altercation about her staying out all night, and it specifically recalls the argument surrounding the issue of her bisexuality. The second report identifies information which came to light through the investigation, which claims that at the time of Sneha's disappearance, she and her brother were not on speaking terms because he had found Sneha and his girlfriend in bed together. I want to be clear that these incidents are noted in actual police reports, because the interesting part about this is that her husband Ron and her brother both claim that these reports are 100% manufactured and are in fact false. Now, the Crime Junkie podcast brings up a good point, and that is that sometimes the families of those that have gone missing or have been murdered will protect the victim's reputation even if they were less than perfect. And the question is this the case for Sneha? I want to state again that no woman, or man for that matter, has ever come forward indicating that they had ever had an intimate relationship with Sneha. And though human nature almost desires a juicy story, this might not be the case at all. What's interesting about this, though, is that people are claiming that Sneha was perhaps bisexual, and remember that the cashier at Century 21 did in fact claim that Sneha was with another woman when she was last known to be seen. I don't know. I don't know what this means, and I don't know if this is true. Investigators did a full search on her computer, and there were no indications that she was having an affair with a man or a woman, and if she decided to disappear without a trace on September 11th, I don't believe that it would have been a planned event, so it's not necessarily indicative one way or the other that her computer didn't render evidence. Now, strange piece of evidence. At around 4 in the morning on September 11th, so we're talking about September 10th into September 11th, the early morning hours, 4 a.m. on September 11th, someone used Ron and Sneha's home phone, so the phone located in their apartment, to call Ron's cell phone. Now, this makes zero sense to me, especially if Ron has indicated that he came home on September 10th and left for work on the morning of September 11th. This has never been fully explained away. And it could be that Ron was calling his voicemail to see if Sneha had left him a message, but what the hell? I mean, I haven't found one resource that claims that this is what happened, and it's never been explained. This makes zero sense to me, and though no one in her family was ever identified as a suspect or a person of interest, this is a blatantly bizarre piece of information that I just don't think could have a logical explanation. Nobody following her sighting on September 10th at Century 21 has ever come forward with knowledge as to where she is or what happened to her, and there has been no activity on any of her bank accounts, which is why the family believes the only conceivable option is that she is one of the many individuals who lost their lives on September 11th following the terrorist attacks. In 2008, she was officially listed as the 2,751st victim of the 9/11 attacks. The family has given the team that identifies bodies from that day a photo of a necklace that she wore nearly every day in hopes that this would be what helps identify her. But Post Secret released an image that will shock you. Post Secret is a sort of social experiment art project hybrid where you can anonymously mail in postcards with secrets, and they received a postcard that has been tied to Sneha's case since its release. And the postcard has an almost watercolor-esque painting of the Twin Towers burning, and it states, "Everyone who knew me before 9/11 believes I'm dead." Wow. We love a juicy story, drama-filled, one where Sneha had a secret life, but is this true, or did Sneha die a hero saving people from the burning towers that day? Please be respectful in the comments. I truly want to hear what your thoughts are, but I also want to be respectful of Sneha and the family. We don't know what happened to her. It has been officially, you know, declared that she is a victim of 9/11. That could be very well the case. It might not be, but I just want to remain very respectful of the family. If you ever have a chance to visit the 9/11 Memorial Museum, I just want to throw one more thing out there, and that is that this space and this scene is not a tourist attraction. It is a memorial for those who lost their lives that day, from those working in the towers to the firefighters who gave their lives saving others. So please just show respect. I left the memorial feeling a lot of things, but I was also unsettled with the knowledge that I saw several people who I felt viewed this place as a tourist attraction taking what I would consider very disrespectful Instagram photos and just conducting themselves in a way that I felt did not honor those who passed on in that space. So please remember that when visiting the memorial if you ever have the chance to go. And with that, I'm gonna head out. Please share your thoughts in the comments below. Please be respectful. I would love to know what you think of this postcard that was sent in to Post Secret. I would love to know what you feel about the possibility that she could have died a hero trying to help save those coming from the burning buildings. Please let me know your thoughts. I will talk to you soon. And with that, I will see you on the next video. Bye, guys.